And for the longest time that we've grown up in this area, when he used to come to church, he used to bring us along. Bring us along with him. But you know what? I don't know only know you as a fisher of man, but a fisherman. If anyone, I follow John on Instagram, not really to be stalkerish or anything. But my dad, for the longest time I remember growing up with my dad, and I think a lot of the people that used to go to church when I was younger, when we went to church in the Kemba, we used to go out on public holidays and things to the beach, and my dad used to go fishing. And I used to remember all the ladies waiting at the shore with their bowls and their salt and knives and their haka, whatever, siaine, manioke, whatever it was, potatoes or bread, waiting for my dad to come in with the fish and stuff like that. So we grew up on the fish. And I have to say, sir, you make me very, very hungry sometimes when I look at somebody who posts. He's not only a fisherman, but he's a fisherman, also a hunter, and a very, very skilled craftsman. I see he makes a lot of knives and things like that. So all of you wives who want a special gift, this is your man looking up on Instagram, John Canoe. It is an honor and a privilege to have you here. I know Dan looks up to you, and it is your ministry. And there is a couple of people that is in our church that come to some, that come to your services, your evening services, and it's just an honor and a privilege to sit under the umbrella of your anointing and the mantle that you carry. And it is an honor to have you here amongst us this morning. So without further ado, Mount Zion Church, stand to your feet and let us praise and worship the Lord God of Zion. Hallelujah. He is holy and he is just and he is worthy of our praise. Hallelujah. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah. gift at the time when people have and they're singing and praising and worshiping you. Father, I pray one thing for this service. That people who are in this room, people who are going to see on the internet, people who will see it back in Tonga, Lord, they'll get a revelation of the knowledge of you. That a revelation of you is what changes our life. A revelation of you is what gives us purpose and destiny.
Yes, God.
And I pray for that increased revelation.
Yes, Jesus.
Open up people's hearts and minds to receive right now. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Awesome. Have a seat, everybody. She's going to interpret from there. So do I wait for the interpretation or just keep talking? I don't have to wait for her to interpret? No, just talk. Cool. I've been talking to Pastor Sinaleki for some time about going and visiting Tonga. Pastor Sinaleki and myself go back a long way. We travelled to Tonga a few times. And they are some of the best memories that I have. In all the years of ministry. And I really want to go back. If Sione in Vavao was watching, you know who I am. Hello. Looking forward to seeing you again one day. Today I want to share with you a story about my ministry revelation. For years and years, I would tell people how to run their life. I'd give them wisdom from the Word of God about how to make right decisions, how to live a good life, how to be spiritual, how to overcome and to be victorious. But I discovered one thing, that some of the young people in our church weren't that on fire. Were on fire. Some of them would go out drinking. Go to the nightclub. And then come to church. I was upset. I said to God, God, what am I doing wrong? That these young people are not on fire. And God spoke to me immediately. And he said, because you do not preach the gospel. I mean, what? You teach them how to live. You put them back under the law. I don't do that. But I was. What I was teaching as good principles for life. What the young people were hearing was, don't do this. Do that. Do it this way. Not that way. And I was subconsciously putting them back under the law. So I stood in front of our church. I apologized for not preaching the gospel properly. And I started to preach the gospel. The gospel of grace. And people started to get a revelation of God's love. The young people would come up to me after the church. They would be laughing with happiness. or crying
as
they started to get revelations of the love of God. They don't go to nightclubs anymore. They don't drink anymore. They're on fire in church, involved in ministry, getting on with their destiny and their purpose of what God has called them for. The revelation that I got from that, there's only one thing that truly changes people's lives. And that's love. Revelation of how much God loves them. See, when religion, and I use the word negatively, comes into our life, it doesn't give us a revelation of God's love. What it does, it shows us where we're not good enough. That we have to change this or change that. We find ourselves being very hard to get the victory in different things in our
lives.
But when you get a revelation of how much you're loved, you automatically change. For example, there's a young man who lives like most young men. He doesn't shower enough. He doesn't clean his teeth. He smells. But then one day, he meets a girl. He loves this girl. The girl shows signs that she loves him. All of a sudden, he doesn't smell anymore. His teeth are nice and white. He showers all the time.
Why?
Love. Love changes people's lives. When we get a revelation of how much God loves us, what we desire changes. And what you desire, when that changes, guess what happens? Your actions change. And for me, the true spiritual life is to seek God to get an increased revelation of how much He loves you. See, religion tells you that you have to love God. And that you have to prove to God that you love Him. Whereas the gospel is the opposite. For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son. So the gospel is the opposite. It's all about how God loves you. And when you get a revelation, it changes your life. Praise be to God. So now our church is full of on fire young people. Because you see, they know how much they're loved. This is the most precious thing. If I only could preach one sermon, I would preach on how much God loves you.
Amen.
And that His absolute will to heal you. So 2 weeks ago, I was praying to God. I said, Lord, we see miracles, but I want to see more. Give me a breakthrough in miracles, Lord. Give me a breakthrough in miracles, Lord. And I've never heard God speak to me in this tone of voice before. It was like he's told me so many times and he was sick of telling me. In my heart, God shouted at me. Don't pray for a breakthrough in miracles. Pray to get a revelation of how much I love you. And miracles just flow. So the next day, there's a woman in our church, very old woman, and she had pneumonia. 2 weeks. Wasn't looking good. So I went around to visit her. And as I sat down to talk with her, I felt the Holy Spirit say to me, this is not a physical sickness, it's spiritual. So I talked to her. The doctors would do swabs to find out what bacteria. So they could give the right antibiotic. But the swab showed no bacteria. So I said, devil, get out. Immediately the presence and peace of God came on her. And 2 days later, she was in church. Absolutely healed. Get a revelation of how much God loves you. Don't ask for power. Ask for a revelation of Him. Because there's something I've noticed. When you are focused on Him, miracles happen. When you focus on the sickness, when you focus on the problem, when you focus on the people, when you focus on this earth, you get nothing. But when you focus on heaven, you get heaven and earth.
Amen.
When you go after the earth, you get nothing. When you go after heaven, you get both. So I want to ask a question. How do you get this revelation? If you're here and you're sick, or you can't get the victory in something in your life, could be a habit, could be an addiction, could be a bad marriage. How do you get this revelation? So that I can have victory in my life too.
Now,
the good thing about the gospel is that it's so simple. God loves you. Punishment you deserve, He took from you. And paid that punishment Himself. So that if you believe and repent, you'll be saved.
Amen.
I've had many people say to me, that's too simple. It's man that makes it complicated. God makes it simple. The verse in the Bible in Corinthians 3:18. It says, as we behold Him, the Bible says, here it is. the spirit of his son into our spirit. Don't worry about that verse. Translate that. Yeah, yeah. Translate what is that? That's a different version. As we behold him, he sends forth the spirit of his son into our spirit. To transform you into his image, into his likeness. So, the question is this. Who transforms who? Does that verse say, you transform you? It says, the Holy Spirit comes into your spirit. And the Holy Spirit transforms you. Religion makes you think about you. Religion makes you focus on yourself. On how good or bad you are. This is pride. Whereas true spiritual life, a true relationship with God, causes you to focus on him. And the Bible says, as we focus on him, that's what it means when it says, as we behold him, he transforms us. As we behold him, he transforms us. So if we stop beholding him, we're not going to be transformed. Think about it. When we look at ourselves, we are not beholding him. I'm beholding me. You are beholding you. You're not focused on him. On his ability to love and transform you. This is so simple. It's almost boring to listen to. But if you get the revelation, it will transform and change your life. And give you victory and healing where there is no victory in healing. What God is asking you to do is stop trying. Stop trying to get the victory. Stop looking at yourself and your bad circumstances or your bad health. Look at him and he will transform you. This is the new covenant. This is the gospel. This is not religion. So, how do we behold him? See, again, that's very simple. Be quiet in here. Sing songs to him. And feel his presence come. Read the word. Come to church. God only wants you to do one thing. Behold him. Because see, he has promised to do the rest. He has promised to do the rest. He doesn't expect you to do it. That's the good thing about the gospel. That's why he gives us the Holy Spirit. It's that simple. As soon as you think, oh, hang on, wait a minute. Don't you have to obey God? Don't you have to do what he says? Don't you have to stop being disobedient? Well, if you live in the Old Covenant, yes. But if you live in the New Covenant, no. Because see, the Bible in the New Covenant is not about trying to change your behavior. It's about transforming you. Because then what you are, you will do. Because when the Holy Spirit, which is there to show us God's love, comes and lives inside you, then you're going to do what God does. And that's to do what is right. That's called righteousness. Righteousness just means to be right with God. To be right with each other. That's all it means. It's not some religious word that we cannot attain. And so the gospel makes us right with God. And now we are righteous. Isn't the gospel simple?
I
love the simple gospel. Since I've been teaching this in our church, we have seen tremendous miracles. People being healed of all sorts of diseases. Is everybody healed? No, not yet. And I use the word yet. Because we're believing for everyone to be healed. So if you're sick, or if you have problems or habits and you don't have the victory and you feel that maybe God doesn't love you as much because of your failure,
can
I say this? God loves you. And the more you realize that, the more victory will come your way. But the secret is not to focus on your victory. The secret is to focus on Him. So come to church. Focus on Him. Behold Him. See how much He loves us. Get into His presence at home. You know, I don't pray a lot. I don't say much. But I like to sit. Say nothing. Just get in His presence. I find my soul becoming full. I find temptation goes away. I find desire to serve the Lord growing stronger. It's that simple. So what I want you to do is position yourself to behold Him. So to position yourself to behold Him, this is what you do. You come to church. You worship God. Spend time in His presence. Read the Word. Now the religious mind will hear this. Thou shalt go to church. Thou shalt read the Bible. Thou shalt sing songs to God. Thou shalt get in His presence. Garbage. But to the mind who understands the love of God, you can't wait. You can't wait to worship God. You can't wait to get into His presence. That's like saying, you have a wife or a husband, thou shalt live together. Thou shalt be nice to each other. No, when you love someone, you just do it.
That's right.
See? The Bible says that we love Him because He first loved us. So if you want to love God, don't try and prove to Him that you love Him. You get revelation of how much He loves you. And you will love Him in return. Simple. Who's watching the World Cup? Who watches the rugby? Now, you don't think, oh, I better make myself do it because it's the right thing to do. No, you can't wait to turn the TV on so you watch the game. Why? Because you love rugby. You love soccer. When you get a revelation of how much God loves you, you love God. And you can't wait to spend time with Him. Simple. We complicate things. It's called religion. So I'm going to finish with this. When the Holy Spirit comes to transform us, He gives us companionship. He gives the revelation of grace. He strengthens us. He gives us a vision for our destiny and our purpose. He helps us to get out, overcome pride and self-focus. He gives us victory. The most important thing He gives us is compassion. Whenever Jesus did something amazing, the Bible says He was moved with compassion. Does it mean you have to go around feeling compassionate all the time? No. That compassion caused you to make a dedication. To commit your life to God's will. One of the best examples I know of that is Pastor Sinaleki Roddy. He's dedicated his whole life to serving his people. Not just his church. Not just his family. All over the world. Do you think he always feels like it? Sometimes I'm sure he'd say, oh, I'd just like to stay home. But no, he gets up. With compassion for his people. To serve them. Why? He's got a revelation of the kingdom. There's so many young people. All these young people here. These young men up the back there. I see lots of little Sinalekis. World changes. But it starts with this one revelation. God loves you. And He wants to touch you right now. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to ask for those who are sick. To raise your hand. And And then we're going to minister to those people. So if you're sick, raise your hand. Now look around you. Quickly raise your hand if you're sick. Keep it up.
You
look around, see these people. I want you to lay hands on them. Now just feel your pain, whatever your pain is.
And
those who are being prayed for, I want you to focus on how much God loves you. And those who are doing the praying, because you're going to pray for these people, I want you to focus on Jesus and how it's His absolute will to see these people healed. So if someone's laying hands on you, you can put your arm down. If no one's got the hand on you, keep your hand up. Well, I want you to start praying for them. I'm going to pray. Sister will interpret for the common people. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, that you confirm your word with signs and wonders. And we thank you, Lord, that you love us. We thank you, Lord, that we can pray your will in heaven be done on this earth. That heaven is not up there, but the will of heaven is here. We speak the will of heaven into this room. We tell darkness to flee. Demons that cause sickness to flee. We cause pain to leave. Depression to go. Heaviness in people's hearts to leave. And in its place, Lord, we speak heaven. We speak peace. The peace of heaven. The peace of God Himself unto these people. Spirit, someone has a spirit of fear. Speak to that spirit of fear to leave in Jesus' name. Because peace will take its place. For healing to come. Sickness go. Healing come. In Jesus' name we pray.
Yes.
Amen and amen.
Yes.
So, who feels the presence of God come onto them? Your hand up and you feel something happening.
Yeah, Jesus.
Who feels like they're either better or getting better?
Oh.
Who is the part that's
sore?
Put your hand up if you feel God's done something. Awesome. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's awesome. Now, you did that. You did that. The best thing about this is that you have the peace and presence of God in you. And when you leave, it goes with you. And whoever you touch, whoever hears your voice, whoever walks in your presence, is affected by the presence of God that you carry. This is the new covenant. This is the gospel. Amen. Amen. Now, sometimes God heals straight away. Bang. Sometimes He heals you a little bit. And over the next few days, you get healed. Make sure you tell your pastor. So the testimony can be given. So that people's faith increases. That's just listening. If you leave this place, people say, oh, the pain's coming back. Get angry with the devil straight away. Say, get off. I take on heaven. Is there sickness in heaven?
No.
And Jesus said, pray like this. Your will in heaven be done on earth. So if it's God's will for no sickness to be in heaven, then it is God's will for heaven to be on you, that there's no sickness on you. So you didn't tell the devil to get out and receive God's blessing and healing.
Amen.
I just want to pray for businesses, then I'm going to finish. Heavenly Father, bless the businesses in this room. Flourish financially. Give them a revelation of why they're going to flourish. Bless the kingdom. In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen.
Thank you. Tapa gina hoka kai e o tua he aho e ni, e wafai kuna o lama.